A few years back, I made a video on the original Digimon World, and to my surprise, a handful of people asked for follow-ups. I was completely blown away that anyone wanted me to talk more about anything, and 8 cringe-filled years later, it's become a bit of an obsession. As my writing and video quality have improved since, at least I think they have, the first 3 videos didn't get the same effort as the later ones, and though they're a reflection of what I considered good at the time, they're not. In the video of old, I did a horrible job describing the game and largely dismissed it as a frustrating babysitting simulator, but that's only partly true and there's some nuance that I missed. When you're focused on the most urgent element, caring for an ostensibly living thing, you miss the forest for the tree that's mid-screech as it drops bough. Digimon World is a game about changing the world of Digimon. There are plenty of titles wherein the heroes or villains have a meaningful impact on the environments and the inhabitants, but few allow you to contour it the way Digimon World does. What always fascinated me was the cyclical nature of play, one which casts a harsh light onto the dark realities of our own lives. You birth a Digimon, work hard to achieve something, complete barely half of what you set out to, and then die, leaving behind offspring who are, you know, vaguely better off. The core loop is twofold. The primary chunk revolves around a dedicated preparatory stage as you oversee your monster companion's growth, and the secondary element is cramming in as much progress before he expires at the ripe old age of 12 days. A majority of the prep consists of blanket stat grinding and some light virtual pet elements such as eating, shitting, and sleeping, you know, the survival trifecta. Once your Digimon's in fighting shape, you're ready for a mad dash through the world in an effort to recruit as many companions as possible to make your next run a little bit easier. The end goal is to restore File City to greatness as an evil hacker enabled the Schizoid Protocol, which saw residents flee, leaving behind the barren remnants you greeted to after being sucked through your own Digivice. Progress is measured in prosperity points, which increase with every monster recruited. Your boy Gigimon gives constant updates on monster allies, and each time a new one joins, he'll rattle off a vague idea of what they've added to the township, as well as a running prosperity tally. These blurbs are aided by a visual representation of what you've achieved, as most Digimon tangibly add to the town in some way. Even when recruits don't erect a shop or offer you their meat, it feels like you've checked another box off your to-do list, which might be underselling it, but is incredibly rewarding in its own right. You never know what each monster's gonna do once they get to town, unless you've played it before, but enough time in the digital world will cement that even useless additions can make good companions, as simply having them strut through the city justifies a lot of the menial shit you'll do to acquire them. Though with each saved monster feeling like a huge milestone, this too means the lack of progress is the inverse. Despite the vague, unfriendly learning curve, the initial guidance on offer is pretty generous, as in addition to dialogues, plenty of hints are heavily telegraphed within the visuals of the world itself. Pre-rendered backgrounds may look comparatively nice, but their ability to mask detail can be detrimental, which is why plenty of RPGs at the time would have explicit markers for the interactive parts. The crushed pixels and tiny screens these games were designed to be played on meant that your stagnantly beautiful scenes could very easily become something of a nightmare to traverse. Digimon World's effort to avoid this was certainly prominent, with giant digital screens slammed in the middle of otherwise natural terrain, so not only were they visually striking due to their absurdity, but the screen could clearly signal the player with arrows and text. Where this differs from something like a modern map marker is that it's not a definitive, explicit declaration on where you ought to be, it's a suggestion, keeping the control in the player's hands, requiring a certain level of decision making. The screens also alert you to exits which are currently inaccessible, indirectly hinting that there are ways to change that. The restriction of these mid to late game areas also offers the player a safer, definitive early direction, keeping the mysteries of the mid game rattling around in their mind. The starting hours foster an environment to make mistakes, which is likely why you're given a rookie monster initially. The alternative would have been 2 Digivolutions within the first 5 minutes before you've even got your bearings. So, dropping formative forms on the player during their second life cycle, after they've achieved a sense of normalcy, makes way more sense. Functionally, starting with the rookie puts you on the same footing as most enemies within the early areas, as well as a few recruitable monsters, which allows for some level of immediate progress. These elements stand out amid the rest of the game's guidance, which is often in the form of text. Due to the dogshit translation, whether or not a string will be reliable intel is a toss-up, though that's not a huge issue, as the core focus is on the exploration of this bizarre island, where even vague directions could be considered hand-holding. It's still no excuse for a poorly translated game, but the alternative is a potential undermining of the exploratory nature, which would remove one of the core elements of playing it at all. I prefer to think of it as a happy accident. The constraints of your freedom are ill-defined, and asking for information can even make these bounds more nebulous, which gives Digimon World an authentic, mysterious feel. NPCs alert you to foraging opportunities as you're granted 3 pieces of meat per day to start with, but often require more, particularly once you acquire champion-level monsters. Scouting the beginner area, the native forest, for Digimushrooms is highly encouraged early on, so even if you're overly cautious, this imbalance pushes the player out of their safe zone, toward adventure. The player can face dive into a hard wall after they've round up most of the early recruits, which is why I suspect a lot of the more fundamentally useful fellas appear in native forest. The first farm upgrade from Palmon, which aids in keeping larger monsters fed, the shortcut opener Kunemon, who grants quicker access to the eastern parts of the forest, as well as the storage Agumon, are all important resources which are immediately accessible and easily recruited, and they make progress and general survival slightly less painful. The zones that come after the forest ramp up the difficulty and are late game thoroughfares, so having an expanded farm, shortcuts and an item bank before that point makes it less bullshit when you venture too far and get one shot by a fucking Tyrannomon that comes out of nowhere. Preparation can be full on depending on your approach, and I will admit it's not a lot of fun spending hours power grinding, but much like reality, if you fail to put in the effort, it's silly to expect anything meaningful in return. Juggling the needs of your companion while you battle the clock will lead to failure, usually manifesting in the form of care mistakes, which are anything a Digimon requires and doesn't receive in a timely manner. Eating, pooping, not getting the shit kicked out of them. If you fail to deliver these at the Digital Man's whim, you cop a care mistake. The player's alerted to a monster's needs through speech bubbles that appear overhead in real time. Well, almost real time. There's a bit of an awkward delay where the game seems like it stutters before displaying this critical information. Even if they did execute immediately, only one need can be displayed at a time, so if a monster's subject to the survival trifecta, you'll have to wait for the food alert to play its animation to see that it also needs a nap. The status screen in the menu always shows monster needs, but having to pause the game to see the VPET elements should be unnecessary when the rest of the game takes intentional measures to occur in real time. If I had the ability to fix one thing in this game, it'd be the weird delay of needs, as it seems like a mild oversight and can actively hinder play. That's whatever. Needs manifest in a variety of ways. Hunger's pretty self-explanatory, Digimon gets hungry, you feed it. There are some intricacies, but they don't really matter. Defecation has some more complexities in that shit happens regardless of toilet, and their placement's sporadic. Occasionally, you'll have to expertly skirt around foes to secure your position on the porcelain throne. No one wants to be nursing a gut gremlin only to have their shit pushed back in. As a horrific aside, the monsters in the Japanese version dish out belly busters at twice the rate of the English game, which means you'd need to stay glued to the seat to cure what ails these diarrhea behemoths. Poop mistakes aren't as much of an issue once porta potties are available and cash flows like a Japanese monster's sphincter, but the early game is still a bit touch and go. Care mistakes manifest in another form, a more sinister form. Overtraining or getting slapped really hard. Excess physical exertion will fatigue your flesh goblins, and there's no real way to cure it. You can temporarily halt it, but generally you've got to take it easy for a day, because if you push too hard, you get injured, and soldiering on with an injury will straight up wipe your monster. Outside of this, the only real negative to digital neglect is that happiness and discipline are lowered. Maintaining a high happiness is correlated with a longer life expectancy, and discipline dictates a monster's willingness to consume the, performance-enhancing microchips you can shove down its throat. If a monster refuses your totally safe regulated silicon, you can scream at it to fix its attitude problem, but too much screaming will tank happiness. This can also generate an ailment that saps your hard-earned stats, so while they are minor elements, they still require careful management, much like everything else in the game. Care mistakes contribute to the process of digivolution, alongside the amount of wins in combat, Digimon weight and stat distributions, age, and probably other things. Navigating the Digivolution tree isn't solely about your achievements, however, as it also celebrates the underachiever, the failure, the bumbling fuckwit. Particular branches require your monster to have fought few battles or to be morbidly obese, generally resulting in Gamermon, but really, you're given every opportunity to make something of any given life cycle, so failing that ultimately comes down to user error. Even ending up with Sukumon or Numemon, the janitors of the digital world, isn't a dead end. You've still got options, as the failed monstrosities can be reverted to their rookie forms for a second attempt at being useful. All of these elements play a major role in progression, as Digivolution stages are the most important factors in going walkies. Not only do higher form monsters have higher base stats, but given that they've been alive for a longer period, we can also assume that they've trained harder. Stages cap at ultimate, as there are no megas. I mean, like, there's a couple, but they fall under the ultimate umbrella. As much as I miss certain fellas in the shrunken roster, ultimates destroy most things in a couple hits, so the inclusion of megas would need more content and a smoother difficulty curve, and I'm pretty happy with how hard the game dunks on you as is. Digimon World is often cited as an unforgiving game, but I think people are hesitant to interface with everything it has to offer, discounting it as too old, chaotic, or poorly translated, when really, you're given every tool and opportunity to succeed. This hesitance may come from how punishing the game can be. I've seen many a defeatist approach wherein any small mistake is treated like a brick wall to concuss yourself on when there are ways around it. Though that's likely a criticism of how people approach games in general, and you know, each to their own, whatever. But Digimon World is often maligned for what I'd consider unfair reasons, my old video being a great example. I didn't stop to think about what I was doing, nor the intended experience, and failed to understand the game as a result. All of my criticisms were superficial as my playthrough consisted of glazed over eyes while I discharged my dopamine receptors instead of actively paying attention. Speaking of, while the gambit of stats are standard, you know, power, defense, intelligence, etc., the gym equipment is unconventional and fits in perfectly with the overall tone. Health is increased by pushing a boulder, defense by taking a spring-loaded left jab to the cheek, and intelligence by flexing your wrinkly mind with the power of Blackboard. Initiating a training session will cost you one in-game hour, regardless of the time spent within that activity, and cancelling at any point pays out the full stat yield. Due to this, the optimal way to train is to initiate an activity, instantly cancel it, and rinse repeat until you're either swole or evolve into a Sukumon, because you covered the gym floor in Little Sukumon. Exercises feature a bonus game, wherein you can time slot reels for increased gains, but as failure results in diminished returns and takes the same duration, with it being incredibly tough to succeed at, you're gonna average out better if you stick to regular training. When a Digimon's maximum lifespan is 15 days or so, you might think that a full hour for a tiny stat increase seems like a lot, and you'd be correct. I can understand why they constrained gains to disallow rookies with max stats steamrolling endgame monsters, but as a player who has to sit through the grind, the duration can and does weigh heavily. Recruited monsters who upgrade the gym come quite late, but there are some unspoken early upgrades. For example, if you train a particular piece of equipment 10 times with a baby or in-training monster, it doubles the stat output. Despite having played the game practically since it came out, I only found out about this recently, but I dig how the rewards don't have to be explicit. By simply doing the correct thing repeatedly, progress becomes far easier in the long run. Once you're pumped and have dumped, you're ready to go for a run, and your biggest obstacle immediately becomes the generic field enemies. Between File City and the various ends of the digital earth exist many Goblimon, Gaburimon, whatever the fuck you want to call them, as well as other color-swapped mongoloids. Combat initiates if you make contact with these roaming freaks, and despite being field enemies, this can happen unexpectedly as their movement patterns are whack. Their direction can sporadically shift in an instant, and the pre-rendered backgrounds mess with depth perception, which can make them tough to consistently avoid. Camera position often obscures parts of the map too, but enemies' aggro ranges aren't beholden to what the player can see, which gives them a strict advantage. On top of that, every time you transition an area, the load screen's shorter than the fade from black, which means the game's moving for about half a second before you've gathered enough visual information to do anything. And that might seem like a negligible amount of time, but if that's what you think, you probably haven't played Digimon World. All of these elements condition you in a way. They force caution where otherwise you'd rush through, and encourage learning what monsters go where and when they're about. Day-night cycles also dictate differing demons, and depending on the map, may make a particular trek easier, further encouraging learning the layouts and formations of these digital fellas. Generics can't be recruited and spawn endlessly, so it's pretty easy to deduce who's a true and honest monster and who's rocking the minstrel paint, but it does take a hands-on approach in certain areas. Combat is also mandatory in a lot of recruitment cases, where you talk to a schizoid monster, give them a slap to fix their head, and return them to camp. Despite this, there's a decent amount of diverse approaches, such as Monochromon, who runs a store and asks you to man it for him. If you upsell enough and hit those KPIs, he'll join the city. But this is a poor example, because while the concept is nice, it's entirely random and fucking sucks. A Frigimon is a pain, as you basically have to poison your own monster, or take a baby to a late game area. Mojimon too, as he needs specific items to be traded to consider joining, and Penguinmon trades a fish for a game of curling, where if you win, he joins the city. And then there's some incredibly intricate specialized recruits, such as getting a Numamon so you can slip him into a big teddy bear suit and liberate Toyland. There's an ice palace in which you need a vaccine type and to move through fake walls with no indicators to unlock Angemon. Myotismon's manor needs a virus type to access, and that one's kinda cool, but I don't think the quest works as intended. It seems like nothing I did produced a consistent result, and he's teleporting all over the place like a dumbass. They're fun asides from the norm, but the cryptic nature can be an issue when you're questioning if they're functioning as intended. Some recruits are just flat out underwhelming, such as Leomon, who mentions his people's history and a secret cave he's been searching his entire life for, but once you find it, he barely even looks at it and then just buggers off to town. Combat can suck, depending on how you approach it. If you're a low IQ troglodyte such as myself, there's an infuriating element to screeching "try your best" at your monster while they fumble around and stare off into the distance, getting blasted by a coordinated enemy. However, if you're rocking a higher brain stat, you'll be granted access to vague attack commands, or the higher tier wherein you can order specific techniques. One of the largest drawbacks to spamming powerful abilities is the available MP pool, but this is easily worked around with a healthy concentration of healing items. The optimal way to play is stocking up on HP and MP recovery and to never stop using them, which minimizes a decent amount of the challenge. Is it an issue that you can spam heal throughout most encounters in the game? Yes, the combat is easily the weakest part, which is bizarre as many of your efforts towards progress exist to make combat easier. New techniques can be acquired randomly throughout skirmishes with monsters of a similar type, or by power leveling your IQ by explaining the difference between Omnimon and Omegamon. Monsters always come with at least one usable tech, so even just moving through the Digivolution tree also aids in expanding your elemental arsenal. I personally find that the less control I have in combat, the more my preparation adds up and counts for something. Being able to explicitly tell the monster to use a major damaging attack means that most foes go down in a couple hits, and using items in battle is a nice safety net, but it undermines the 6 hours you just spent in the gym, where training past a certain level is pointless if you can buy your way through the game. To end, I'd love to discuss topics I very rarely talk about, which are the visuals and sound. I typically don't cover these because you've got eyes and ears, and I couldn't begin to understand why shit looks or sounds good, but I think I've played enough Digimon World to at least have a crack. Even just glancing at this game, you can tell there's a unique quality to it, which you don't often see, that is the seamless merging of the natural and mechanical, where nothing feels out of place, but equally, everything feels out of place. Right from the get-go, you sneak a peek at Gigimon's house, a cardboard box with a rusty tin can for a front door, resting in front of some tilled land with meat growing from the ground. The restaurant is situated inside a convection oven, the trees have electric plugs at the bottom of them, and if you wander around enough, you'll notice some fell trees and empty sockets. The ground in File City fades from a healthy grassy field to a sequence of circuits, showing that what we're subject to is less Mother Nature, more motherboard. At any point, industrial infrastructure will be effortlessly merged with otherwise naturally forming terrain, and it brings into question the rules of nature and how it was made. If you look at certain areas, you'll see small patches of grass growing throughout solid metal structures, which could mean the digital world was originally man-made and overtaken by more naturally occurring elements. Or perhaps, whoever created it simply designed it to appear as though it were an earthly environment, when really, it's just a binary expression. The cracks on the direction screen things in the ground and the general rundown feel show that the world is subject to its own age, with garbage washing up on the beaches and random functional vending machines everywhere, cementing that there's also a bit of a garbage crisis. The parallels to our own world are striking, but outside of the purely visual theming, there's probably a deep dive opportunity here if you're a Digimon fan. I'm sure someone will do it. Maybe there's nothing to it, and the world just exists the way that it does because some guy did some crude renders for a PlayStation game, but what a bizarre, exciting landscape that aids in the adventurous feel by being so familiar, yet foreign. Maps also feature intentional angles due to the pre-rendered backgrounds, with some of the pans fully detailing the scope of the world, which can make traversal a bit iffy, but it never becomes visually dull. Aiding in this style is, of course, the accompanying soundtrack, and to this day, I've still never heard anything like it. Whether that's a reflection on video game music in general, or my own ignorance of video game music remains to be seen, but I've still never seen it done quite like this. The File City theme is a simple sequence of notes over a simple town. The sharp string plucks inspire a sense of wonder and curiosity at the greater world around you, while letting you know that the town you're in is safe. The night variance is also simplistic, but calm and soothing. It's the kind of thing you could take a deep breath to as the world melts away around you. The perfect set of dings and dongs that inspire a tranquil feeling deep within, aided by the soft hum in the background. It's just pleasant. Exiting File City, the native forest demonstrates one of the reasons I adore sound in this game, the complete lack of music and solely relying on ambient noise. It's just birds tweeting with a slight echo, literally no other sound. It invokes the inherent beauty of the outside world to drive home how absent and natural this particular area is. The nighttime variant adds crickets and vague rustling, alluding to creatures shuffling around getting they freak on, minor touches that in execution went a long way to build these scenes. Drill Tunnel also has no music, just the majestic sounds of drilling rock with metal. The echo gives it a hollow feeling which the newly tunneled tunnel should sound like. This creates a void of sound in which the effects are given room to shine. The squeaky bounce of the protagonist's footsteps as the digital goblin shuffles along behind, the crunch of food beneath his teethies, the tummy grumbles, and the following result of a grumble tum, the domestic violence, it all fits so well that you never really notice it, yet without it, there'd be something sorely missing. Great Canyon has howling winds and an ominous air to it. As it directly connects to Friesland, you can hear the adjacent chill on the breeze. Once inside Friesland, the wind is harsher, more chaotic, with a low rumbling beneath it. It captures the oppressive atmosphere, perfect for a late game area. The music tracks are all amazing. I can't really convey that because I'm a music pleb, but they never feel out of place. Tunes like Factorial Town sound metallic and give a real synthy, grungy feel, with brass trumpets and shit over the top. Now, the ultimate blending of these two elements is a catchy PS1 beat with ambient noise blended throughout, which is where we find Tropical Jungle's music. It's an up-tempo tribal beat with bird and chimp noises layered into it, which gives it such an authentic feeling. The Night variant is a slower beat with more sporadic nocturnal animal noises, but still does a hell of a job orally putting me in these areas. I can't find any info on the composers outside of their supposed names, but they did a fantastic job, as without their compositions, Digimon World would not have half the appeal that it does. They crafted an audio experience that enhanced the atmosphere to such an extent that I can't imagine the game without it. The music has also stuck with me personally for well over 20 years and deeply awakens a time I can never return to, with associated memories I'll never forget. Mostly of playing Digimon World. And that's Digimon World for the PS1. I feel like I can finally categorize this video as slightly less cringe. That music bit was pushing it though. I'll see you next time for Digimon World 2.